Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers, a non-denominational church desiring to fulfill God's will. We invite you to join us in an atmosphere of praise and worship and the powerful teachings of Christ delivered in a most creative way that reaches every age. Located at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard in Greensboro, North Carolina, on the wonderful campus of Gillespie Park Elementary School. This year, we're focusing on building a foundation solidified by grace, with walls made by faith, and our homes being filled with salvation by being united in living devotion. We promise you, visiting us online or in the sanctuary will be an experience that will be life-changing and one you'll never forget. We hope to see you soon. Services begin at 11 a.m. Have a blessed day.
Amen. Anybody got a testimony that God is awesome? Oh, come on. Does anybody have a testimony that God is awesome? In your testimony, can you say he's a deliverer? Come on, has he been a deliverer? In your testimony, can you say he's a healer? Come on, can you let somebody else know that he's a healer? Maybe God has been a provider. Maybe you want to just let somebody know just that your God is a provider. I don't know, maybe he's protected you. Maybe somebody needs to know that God is a protector. I don't know about you, but we serve an awesome God. And you ought to be able to let somebody else know just how awesome God is. Amen? That ought to be something in your spirit. Amen? That he's an awesome God. Jesus. Genesis chapter 1. Amen. Genesis chapter 1. Ever read Genesis before? Ever read Genesis chapter 1? Amen. He's an awesome God. Amen. Ought to be your testimony to him. Amen. That God, you're awesome. You're just, not that he don't know. Not that you don't know your family don't love you. Not that you don't know that your friends don't love you. But it sure is good to hear him just say it sometime, ain't it? I'm sure God just loves to just hear us say it sometime. Amen. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 31. It reads, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over everything that moveth upon the earth." Say, moveth upon the earth. "And God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in which is the fruit of a tree-yielding seed. To you it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." Say very. "And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." Amen? Let us pray. Father God, first and foremost, we say thank you. God, thank you again for this time and this moment, God. Thank you for who you are and for what you do. Lord, it's preaching time, God, and we would ask that the word would be shared in a way that you would have it to be done. And so in its sharing, Father God, we ask that you would open up our ears, our hearts, and our minds, that we would receive what thus saith the Lord, and not just be hearers only, but to be doers as well. Father, we need you and cannot make it without you. Every step of the way, God, we need you, for you are an awesome God. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. You may be seated. Title for today, Look at the Evidence. Look at the evidence. Look at the evidence. I've come to find that it's very hard for someone to move forward if they don't know who they are. Come to find that a lot of young men, young women lose their way as they get older because they don't know who they are. They're searching, trying to find out who they are. They're looking for where they came from. They're looking for some history and taking this history to say, this is who I am. I'm sure it's a billion-dollar business right now for folk to be able to look up ancestry.com, to look up all these other different things, your DNA search and all that, all in the guise of people trying to find out who they are. Amen? And so if it becomes so important to find out who you are in the natural, I would surmise that it's also very important for you to find out who you are spiritually. Amen? Look at the evidence. Look at the evidence. There's a lot of crime shows on TV. A lot of crime shows, a lot of all that kind of stuff. And I don't know, maybe you might be addicted to looking at them like me sometimes. I like that kind of stuff. But in every single crime show, the detectives start out, there's something that happens, and they start out, and the first thing that they do once they step on the scene is they start to do what? Look for evidence. Look for evidence. And the evidence, the things that they find, these little bits and pieces of evidence here and there, ends up pointing them into the direction to find out who was actually the culprit of this whole situation, whatever it was. Amen? Look at the evidence. In Genesis chapter 1, we find some very intriguing stuff. We find some stuff that many theologians have debated for quite some time. Some people say, well, this six-day creation took thousands and thousands of years. I'm, for one, and the one that believes that it literally was six 24-hour days. That's the way I look at it. The reason I look at that and when I see scripture, because he says the evening and the morning came and that was a day. Evening and the morning came and that was a day. I want you to go ahead and go with me, if you will. Here is nothing. God speaks to nothing. Let there be light. Light comes. Fermentation comes. Earth comes. Water comes. Seeds come. Plants come. All kinds of creatures in the air, in the sea, upon the earth. Come. And after all of these things are created, and we have the sun and the moon and the stars, and after all these things are created, God says, and now let us create man. And in creating man, let's not just create him to be anything like we've ever created before, but now in creating man, let's create him in our own image. And as he's created, let us not just create him just to be there, but let's give him power. Let's give power over everything else that has already been created so that there would be none other power for walking the earth than man. And even after all of that was done, after all the other days that God created things, he said that it was good. But on the sixth day when he created, he said it was very good. Amen? Amen. Look at the evidence. For those that don't know, and for those who don't have a full understanding of who you are, I want to direct you today to look at the evidence. You are that important to God. No matter what you're going through, no matter what's happening, no matter what it seems like, you are that important to God. That out of all the things that he created in the world, he chose that once he created you to say, that it's very good. No matter what anybody else wants to say about you, no matter how anybody else wants to look at what you've done or what you haven't done, God says you are very good. As you go on and you read more in Genesis, you'll start to see that even how he started to give him more things. And in doing so, and not only just being very good, he says, now I'm going to give you the breath of life. In other words, I'm going to pour my spirit out upon you. Amen? Very good. Very good. Anybody ever felt less than at any time in their life? Anybody ever felt unworthy? Well, I want to show you in some of these other scriptures, although we started out in Genesis, I want to show you that you're guilty of being loved by God. Amen? Anybody believe that? Guilty of being loved by God. So I have some scriptures for those that are writing notes. You want to write some stuff down. Amen. He loves us so much that he bowed the heavens also and came down. That's how much God loves us. Here's a clue. Here's some evidence found in Psalm 18. And he sent from above, he took me and drew me out of many waters. Also found in Psalms 18. So you mean to tell me, God, who is all-knowing, God that is all-powerful, took out of his own time just to look after little old me? There's evidence that we're loved by God. Amen? He loves us so much that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Found in Hebrews chapter 13. You mean to tell me, after all I've been through and after how many people have left me in my life and after so many people seemingly didn't care no more, that through it all God was always there? Amen? Hebrews 13. For the mountains shall depart and the hills shall be removed, but my love shall not depart from thee, neither shall my covenant of peace be removed, saith the Lord that have mercy upon thee. Isaiah 54. Amen. As the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his love towards them that fear him. Psalm 103. Many are the afflictions of the righteousness, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. He keepeth all his bones, and not none of them is broken. Psalms 34. Even though I'm afflicted, even though I go through, God still delivers me from all of that mess. That's one of the reasons that I said that during that song of singing Awesome, I wanted you to just stop and concentrate just on you. Because I wanted you to really think about what you've been through. I want you to really think about the things that has happened in your life. I don't want you to just think of the good. I want you to think of all the bad stuff. I want you to think about when you were picked at, when you were talked about, when you were bullied, when you were said you was unworthy, when you were said there's no way in the world that's going to happen but God. But God delivered you from all of that. And if there's something going on right now that you're feeling unworthy of or whatever, that's something that you're holding on to, not the standard that God places you at. Amen? Amen. When you pass through the waters, which is trouble, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they won't overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you won't be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, for I am the Lord. You are precious in my sight, and I love you. Isaiah 43. When trouble comes your way, then it said, define water as being trouble. But then he says, even when the river comes. So it's one thing to be a puddle of water. Come on, somebody. It's another thing to be having to deal with a river. But no matter how it comes, God still got it. That sounds like a clue, doesn't it? Some evidence. I mean, we're trying to prove whether God loves us or not, right? Amen? Anybody feeling loved yet? God commands his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. So the wages of sin is death. That's what's supposed to happen. There's several different examples throughout the Bible where the wage of sin was immediate. Soon as the sin occurred, death ensued. But the other part of that is that, but the gift from God is eternal life. And not just life, but life more abundantly. Amen? This is the God that we serve? Sounds like evidence to me. Amen? Come on, this is familiar. Say it with me. For God so loved. Come on, what's the rest of the scripture? For God so loved the world that whosoever. That's how much God loves you? That's how much God loves us. Amen. Look at the evidence. Having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them to the end. John 13. To the end. If you're a believer, when is your end? Your end is everlasting. So he says, I'll love you to the end. That means I'll love you forever. Amen, amen, amen. Somebody getting it. Somebody getting it. In Romans 8. What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall your tribulation? Amen, amen, amen. What about distress? Persecution? Famine? Nakedness? Peril? Or the sword? It says, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I want to encourage someone today to look at the evidence. Stop walking around as a believer with your head bowed. And I'm not talking about bowing your head in reverence, but bowing your head as though you're unworthy. Stop letting the things that are happening in the world, I don't care about the politics, I don't care about the wars, I don't care about the rumors of wars, I don't care about your issue, I don't care about your shortcoming, I don't care about when you mess up. Look at the evidence. No matter how much sin you got in your life, no much how much, Pastor, I just seemingly can't get over this issue. It's this one thing that just keeps bothering me, and I can't, no matter how bad it is, I need you to look at the evidence. I only gave you a few scriptures. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved. Look at the evidence. You feel less than, pick up your Bible. It ain't going to take long for you to find that God loves you. Look at the evidence. This week, I was going through, I was doing whatever. We had our advisory ministry meeting yesterday, and I told everybody in the advisory ministry, I said, this afternoon, we were just talking about what we were going to do, and I said, I want to go work in the garden, but I know it's about to rain, so I want to get X amount done. So as I went out there in the garden and I had my little stuff set up, I had everything rain ready. Everything rain ready. I had my phone and I had my little waterproof speaker that was out there while I was in the back of the garden. I had all my tools laid out, so if something needed to happen, they just gonna lay there and get wet. Amen, praise the Lord. I even started a fire in the backyard. You know, I said, hey, it's gonna rain. You know, it's nice to have a little fireplace while I'm doing this. It's cool, it's cool. And so I started working. And I raked up the ground and I moved it around. And what did I plant? I planted some callaloo. I planted some green beans. Planted some other stuff. I planted some squash. I got it planted. I got everything moved around and planted and covered up. And I was like, whoa, the wind's blowing. The clouds are here, but it ain't rained yet. I said, well, this rain is coming. This rain is coming. I got to get these seeds in the ground. Well, I already had some stuff planted and I had some mulch. And I said, well, I know what I'll do. I'm layer composting in my garden. I said, I'll go ahead and spread some mulch around. So I grabbed a trash can and I filled it up with mulch and kept just moving the mulch around and spreading it around and getting it all together. I said, wow. Before I know it, I looked up. I had all the mulch spread. I had some greens, some turnip greens and some other things from last year that was still growing. I was trying to let seed out so I can get some more seeds to replant. I said, well, let me pull those up and let me take care of those. Went ahead and pulled up all of those. And yet still the rain had not come. God just working it out. God just taking care of it. Now, the weatherman said the rain was going to come. I'm going somewhere. The weatherman said the rain was going to come. I did my best to prepare for it, whether it came or not. But God didn't let the rain come just yet. You know how like some people say that you can't? You know how people start to say stuff, well, you don't have the education, you don't have this degree, you don't have this money in your pocket, you don't have this resource, you can't. But when you turn around and look at the evidence, that's the type of God that we serve. God knew my heart's desire. Y'all can say what you want to. I think he healed the rain up just for me. I think he healed it up just for me. Deacon Stacy said, me too. I was able to get all of that done. Able to get it done. So last night, sat back. I was like, okay, hey, I got that done. I don't have to worry about, you know, I got my seeds out there. I got a couple more things I want to plant, but I got to go to the store and buy some more tomato plants. I'm like, okay, got that done. Last night I'm laying in the bed. Water's just coming down. It's just raining. It's just raining. Beating against the house, and I'm sitting in the bed just a smiling. Woke up this morning, it was still raining. I said, the Lord is out there watering that stuff right there. Amen. Turned on the TV, got the forecast, and not only is it going to rain all day, it's going to rain tomorrow too. I said, look at that. I said, well, it's going to rain. So let me go ahead and get up and get dressed this morning. Let me go find something to put on. I go in the closet. I find this suit right here. Hope it looks okay. Find a suit right here. God had something to minister to me about this suit. When I first gave my life to Christ, I didn't have church clothes to wear. I had club clothes. So I would come to church in my club clothes. That was the best clothes I had, so that was my club clothes. Had my little silk and my rayon, couldn't tell me nothing. A little bit aged there. Some people Googling rayon, what is that? Okay, anyway. have a little stuff on. And I said, I want to go get me a suit. Look at the evidence. But I didn't have the money to go to buy the suit, so I went to a consignment shop. and I bought a suit for $25. And I took it to, what do you call them people? Taylor. Took it to a tailor for the tailor to go ahead and tailor my suit. And this is the suit that the tailor tailored. Amen? And so I had this suit up in the closet, like in the back, because the last time I had tried it on, looking a little young on a brother, you know what I'm saying? I just call it young. I got to say all them other words. We just say it was looking young. Looking young on me. But as I put the suit on, I started looking at the evidence. I said, wow, I remember. And I done been through. But now God got us right here. You mean to tell me this been all the way through to God loves me. And I want to encourage somebody today. You are guilty. You are all guilty. Every single one of us. You listening on the radio, wherever, you are guilty. Guilty of being loved by God. In spite of your shortcomings. In spite of where you've messed up. In spite of what anybody else got to say, you're guilty. God just asks for acknowledgement in return. Scripture says, time is coming where every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Ever thought about that? Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. You mean to tell me all of this was so that man would acknowledge you? All of this so that man would say, in spite of God, you're God. God, in Genesis, that was able to do all these wonderful things, didn't have to allow us to be the way that we are. We all could look the same. We could all be the same height. We could all walk around here just like robots, doing exactly what it is that he said. But he said, no. I'm going to let you be your own individual. I'm going to let you make the choice. I'm going to let you go through whatever you go through, whatever happens. All the while, I'm going to be right there. And at the end, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Whether they get it now, whether they have to get it later, this is the outcome. Be encouraged to look at the evidence. These scriptures right here in Genesis, these few that we broke down, if you just look at this from the beginning, these few, he created them, male and female. He said, here's the command, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue it, have dominion upon everything that moveth upon the earth. Everything. There's nothing in your life that you can't speak to. There's no situation that you can't put word on. Look at the evidence. Use what it is God, you going through, use what it is God has given you. You have dominion over it. You've had dominion over it. The situation might be the way that it is now because you let it go. What a place it would be. How would your life be if you took control over everything? I don't mean take control like you the one that's orchestrating it all in the background, but you took control and said, in spite of how it looks, in spite of how it sounds, in spite of how it feels, God is still awesome. Oh, Pastor, you don't understand what I'm going through. I don't have to understand what you're going through. I understand the remedy to it. And the remedy is stop trying to hold on it and do it yourself. Turn it over to him and use what he's given you. Dominion. He's given you power to speak it. Not only to speak it, but to believe it. He's given you power to say, look, you ain't got to yell at me over yonder in the corner because I'm right here with you going through it. I wrapped myself in flesh and I've felt pain before. So when you're telling me that you're hurt, I understand hurt. I felt betrayal before. So when you tell me that you've been betrayed, understand that. Every single part of anything that we're going through, it's nothing that we can go through that God doesn't understand. Not only does he not understand it, but then he gives us the example. The example in Jesus Christ, not only do I understand it, but I conquered it. I beat it. Everything that you got going on, I beat it. I didn't just barely beat it. I didn't just slip through the back door and beat it. No, I came walking out in front with my head held high. And then after I beat it, I told him, you ain't nothing. That's the type of God that we serve. And then he said, not only did I come and defeat it and beat it, but then I turned around and gave it a time limit and said, look at here, I'm coming back. I'm coming back. And for the other ones that you've jumped on and for the other ones that have gone through, I'm coming back. And when I'm coming back, I'm not just coming back by myself. But when I'm coming back with my bride. My bride, which is the church. And the Bible says that we'll be with him forevermore. Forevermore. Look at the evidence. In spite of what you got going on, in spite of how you feel, in spite of what it looks like, look at the evidence. God's given you everything that you need. Amen? Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord. Do you think God deserves more? Amen. Amen, amen, amen. I don't think God would give an encouraging word without knowing, because he's all-knowing, without knowing that you possibly might be in the middle of something, might be coming out of something, or might be getting ready to get into something. To give an encouraging word, to walk into your destiny. To give an encouraging word, in spite of all the other stuff, to walk into your destiny. Look at the evidence. This is the type of God that we serve. Amen? It's personal decision time. Personal decision time. And with it being personal decision time,